Hello, I am Dr. Rajita. Welcome to Anatomy Classes. Today's session, we shall start with a case study. The case is a 45-year-old male presented with upper abdominal pain for past 3 months. Increase in pain intensity for past 10 days. Pain reduces in intensity after food intake. Had mild tenderness at epigastric region. Underwent endoscopy, which is inserting a long tube with a camera into the esophagus, stomach and duodenum to visualize the mucosa of upper gastrointestinal tract. So this is how the patient had endoscopy, where a tube was inserted till the duodenum with a camera. And after viewing, there is a pathology which is seen in the wall of the duodenum. So to understand the duodenal pathology, it is very important to know the anatomy of duodenum. So in the case, we understood the organ involved is the duodenum. So to know the surgical importance, we should understand the anatomy of duodenum. Duodenum is the word which is derived from Latin, which is actually derived from du, deca, dactyl. Du means 2, deca means 10, and dactyl means fingers. So it is present with a length of 12 fingers breadth. So duodenum is the term which is first used by Herophilus. He was an anatomist during 300 BC. So that is about the duodenum term. And coming to the location of the duodenum, to understand the location, we are dividing the abdomen into 9 quadrants. And the 9 quadrants are right hypochondric, left hypochondrium, in middle is the epigastrium, then right lumbar, left lumbar, in middle where the umbilicus is present is the umbilical region, then right iliac, left iliac, and hypogastric region. So these are the 9 quadrants. Location of the duodenum, it is located in the mainly in the umbilical region. We can see it is present above to the level of umbilicus, and partially it extends into the right lumbar region and into epigastric region. Vertebral relation, it is present between L1 to L3 vertebra. So the total length of the duodenum is 25 centimeters. So 12 fingers breadth, 25 centimeters is its total length, and it is actually the first part of small intestine. It is the continuation of pyloric part of the stomach. So the first part of the small intestine, the total length of the small intestine is 6 meters. Only initially first 25 centimeters is formed by the duodenum. And duodenum, it is divided into 4 parts. The first part having a length of 2 inches, second part is of 3 inches, and third part, it is the length of 4 inches, the third part is of 4 inches, and the last part, the fourth part, is of 1 inch length. The fourth part is 1 inch length. The first part is the continuation of the pyloric part of the stomach, and it is of 2 inches in length, and initial 1 inch is the mobile part which is covered by the peritoneal folds, and the distal 1 inch is the fixed part which is a retroperitoneal part which is anteriorly covered by the peritoneum. And it ends by forming a turn or a flexure which is called as superior duodenal flexure. It is called superior duodenal flexure. Superior duodenal flexure continues to form the second part, and second part again takes a turn which is called as inferior duodenal flexure. Inferior duodenal flexure. Inferior duodenal flexure continues to form a horizontal part, which is the third part of the horizontal part ends up by taking an upside ascending curve, which is called as the distalmost part and fourth part of duodenum. So these are the 4 parts of duodenum. The first part is present at the level of L1. Second part is extending from the L1 to L3, and third part is horizontally related to the lower border of the L3, and fourth part takes an upturns towards the L2. So these are the four parts of duodenum. So we shall begin with the first part of duodenum. First part of duodenum, the initial 1 inch of the first part is covered by the peritoneum, and distal 1 inch is not covered by the, means it is a retroperitoneal part. So the distal part here is the retroperitoneal. The yellow line represents the peritoneum covering, and it is covering only the anterior part of the duodenum. This is the sagittal view of the cut section of duodenum. Duodenum is present here. This is the sagittal section. Here is the anterior side of the duodenum. This is the posterior side of the duodenum. Is a C-shaped organ where within the concavity of the C, the head and the neck of pancreas are related. So we shall see first with the first part. Anteriorly it is covered by the peritoneum, so it is retroperitoneal. Posteriorly it is not covered by the peritoneum. And here we can see it is related to the anteroinferior part of the liver, which is called as quadrate lobe of the liver, and part of the gallbladder. So anteriorly two structures are related, quadrate lobe of liver and gallbladder. Posterior to the duodenum, the first structure here we are seeing, this is the bile duct, and behind the bile duct there is an artery which is the gastroduodenal artery. Gastroduodenal artery, here we can see it is a branch coming out arising from common hepatic artery. Common hepatic artery is in turn the branch of celiac trunk. Common hepatic artery descends to an ascending and descending branch. The one which is running upwards is called as proper hepatic artery, which goes to the liver, whereas the one which is coming down supplies the duodenum and the stomach, so it is called as gastroduodenal artery. So, and next to gastroduodenal artery, here we can see the portal vein. The portal vein is joined by two veins, that is the splenic vein and superior mesenteric vein, both joins to form the portal vein. Here is the portal vein. So these are the posterior relations of the first part of duodenum. Posteriorly it is related to bile duct, it is related to gastroduodenal artery and portal vein. Next, see, we'll see about the superior relations. Superior means here, above it is related to the epiploic foramen, which is also called as foramen of Winslow, present within the peritoneal cavity, opening present in the peritoneal cavity. And inferiorly it is related here, neck of the pancreas, and it is related to head and neck of the pancreas. So these are the relations of the first part. Here the second picture shows again the relations from the anterior view. Here is the sagittal view, this is the anterior view. So I am going to draw the duodenum here. This is the first part of duodenum. So first part of duodenum, it is overlapping these three structures. We can see first one is the gastroduodenal artery, next to it is the bile duct, and behind it is the portal vein. Portal vein is joined by two veins, that is superior mesenteric vein and splenic vein joins to form the portal vein. So these are the posterior relations of the first part of duodenum from anterior view. This is the sagittal view showing the anterior, posterior, superior and inferior relations of first part of duodenum. We shall continue with the second part of duodenum. Continuing with the second part of duodenum, second part of duodenum where it is approximately 3 inches in length, and first part was 2 inches in length, that is around 5 centimeters, and second part which is of 3 inches in length, approximately around 7.5 centimeters. Second part is the vertical part of the duodenum, which is present on the right side in the abdomen. And it is extending between the superior duodenal flexure to inferior duodenal flexure. Embryologically, the second part is very important because inside the duodenum, in the middle of the duodenum, there is an opening which is called as major duodenal papilla. and which divides the duodenum into upper proximal half, which is developed from the foregut, and lower half, which is developed from the midgut. So embryologically, duodenum is like a watershed line where the upper half is from the foregut and lower half is from the midgut. That is about the second part of duodenum. And coming to the peritoneal relations of duodenum, it is a retroperitoneal organ. Second part is completely retroperitoneal. Anteriorly, it is covered by the peritoneum, and posteriorly, it is not covered by peritoneum. So it is fixed, it is immobile. And little part where the transverse colon is traversing, there it is directly related to the transverse colon, where that part is not covered by peritoneum anteriorly. We shall see the relations now. Here is the anterior view to show the anterior relations, and this is again the anterior view. After removing all the anterior structures, we can see the posterior relations. So beginning with the anterior relations of the second part of duodenum, anteriorly it is overlapped by the right lobe of liver. This is on the right side, so it is overlapped by right lobe of the liver, and it is traversed by the transverse colon. It is traversed by transverse colon, which is covered by a peritoneum which is called as transverse mesocolon. So transverse mesocolon also related to anterior side of the duodenum. And inferiorly, the second part is also related to the coils of small intestine, which is the loops of small intestine, that is jejunum, loops of jejunum. And it is also related to the gallbladder, partially it is related to gallbladder. So these are the anterior relations. Now you, after removing all these organs, we are going to see the posterior relations of duodenum. Posteriorly, the duodenum is present over the kidney, that is the right kidney. So medial border of the right kidney where the hilum is present. So the second part is present along the hilum of the right kidney, and the renal vessels which are opening into the right kidney, which are called as right renal artery and right renal vein. I can't show here because duodenum is present overlapping them. So right renal arteries and right renal veins, which are present towards the right kidney, are also related to it. And we can see here, this is the inferior vena cava. The right border of the inferior vena cava is also related to duodenum. And there is a muscle here which is running from the posterior side of the kidney, and this is the psoas major, right psoas major. So these are the posterior relations. I'll just repeat again, it is related to right hilum of the right kidney, it is related to right renal vessels, it is related to inferior vena cava, right border of the inferior vena cava, and right psoas major. So medially it is related to the head of the pancreas, and laterally it is related to the flexure, that is called as hepatic flexure of the colon, where the ascending colon turns to form the transverse colon. This turn is called as hepatic flexure because it is related to liver. So on the right side it is related to hepatic flexure, on the left side it is medially it is related to the head of the pancreas. So these are the relations of the second part of the duodenum, and we shall see about the third and fourth part of the duodenum. Moving on to the third part of duodenum, which is the horizontal part of duodenum, and it is the longest part among all parts. The length is around 10 centimeters, that is approximately is around 4 inches in length, and it is continuation from the inferior duodenal flexure from the right side, and it crosses the inferior vena cava, abdominal aorta, and after crossing the abdominal aorta, it ascends up to continue to form the fourth part of duodenum. So that is about the horizontal third part of duodenum. And peritoneal relations, it is a retroperitoneal organ. So anteriorly it is covered by the peritoneum, and posteriorly it is devoid of peritoneum. Anteriorly, only at one area it is not covered by peritoneum, that is where the superior mesenteric vessels passes. So there the root of mesentery will get reflected, the peritoneum, which is called the mesentery, gets reflected. So this part of the third part is devoid of peritoneum. And let's see the posterior relations of the third part. posteriorly it is related to right ureter, it is related to the right psoas major, it is related to inferior vena cava, and it is related to abdominal aorta. And we can see some branches arising from abdominal aorta forming posterior relations. Here are the gonadal arteries, right and left gonadal arteries. In males, it is a testicular artery, and in females, they are ovarian arteries. And we can see even the origin of inferior mesenteric artery. Inferior mesenteric artery gets originated behind the third part of duodenum. Higher above, we can see the origin of superior mesenteric artery, which crosses anteriorly the third part of duodenum. So that is about the posterior relations. And superiorly, it is related to the pancreas, that is the head and neck of the pancreas, including the uncinate process. And inferiorly, it is related to the coils of small intestine. So these are the relations of the third part. Now let's see the fourth part, which is the shortest part. The length of fourth part is 2.5 centimeters, approximately 1 inch in length. 1 inch in length. And anteriorly, it is overlapped by the stomach along with the lesser sac, and it is also traversed by the transverse colon along with the transverse mesocolon. So those are the anterior relations. Posterior relations, now the fourth part of duodenum is present on the left side of the abdomen. So it is related to the branches from the left of the abdominal aorta, which is the left renal artery. We can see it is arising from the abdominal aorta, and along with the down, we can see the origin of left gonadal artery. So left gonadal artery is related, left renal artery is related, and we can see the sympathetic chain present lateral to the abdominal aorta, that is the left sympathetic chain, and a tributary of the splenic vein, that is inferior mesenteric vein, which drains into the splenic vein. So these are the posterior relations of the fourth part. I'll repeat again: left sympathetic chain, inferior mesenteric vein, left renal artery, and left gonadal arteries, that is testicular artery in male and ovarian artery in female. So after the relations of duodenum, we shall see about a ligament which is related to duodenum, called as suspensory ligament of duodenum, which is also called as ligament of Treitz. And this is a fibromuscular band which is attached above to the diaphragm and below to the duodenum. To see, the diaphragm is a skeletal muscle which separates the thoracic cavity from abdominal cavity, and it has got the right crest and the left crest of the diaphragm. And from the inferior surface of the right crest of the diaphragm, we see the attachment of this fibromuscular band, and it runs downwards, and it runs posterior to the pancreas along the posterior abdominal wall, and attaches to the third part of duodenum, which is this horizontal part, fourth part of duodenum, and the junction between the duodenum and jejunum, which is called duodeno-jejunal flexure. So it is attaching to the third part, fourth part, and duodeno-jejunal flexure. The attachment of the suspensory ligament varies from individual to individual. And this fibromuscular band, the components of it, if we see, the upper part consists of skeletal muscle fibers which are derived from the diaphragm, and the middle part of it consists of elastic fibers, and lower part of it consists of smooth muscle fibers which are from the duodenal wall of the duodenum. So that is about this ligament of Treitz. It is important functionally because the contraction of this ligament reduces the angle between the duodenum and jejunum. That is, at the duodeno-jejunal flexure, the angle gets reduced, allowing the free movement of food, passage of food from the duodenum into the jejunum. That is the function. And embryologically, it is important because during the rotation of midgut, it acts as like an important landmark, and we shall understand along with the rotation of the midgut. So that is about the suspensory ligament of Treitz or suspensory ligament of duodenum. And we shall see now the blood supply of duodenum. Blood supply of duodenum, we know that the duodenum, in the second part of a duodenum, inside there is an opening which is called as major duodenal papilla. Above to the major duodenal papilla, the duodenum develops from the foregut, and below to the major duodenal papilla, the duodenum develops from midgut. So the artery of the foregut is the celiac trunk, and artery of the midgut is the superior mesenteric artery. Superior mesenteric artery is the artery for midgut. So the branches from the celiac trunk supplies the upper part of the duodenum. Branches from the superior mesenteric artery supplies the lower part of duodenum. If we see exactly, the branches are mainly it is supplied by superior pancreatico-duodenal artery, which is indirectly the branch of celiac trunk. And the lower part of the duodenum is supplied by inferior pancreatico-duodenal artery, which is the branch of superior mesenteric artery. Apart from superior pancreatico-duodenal arteries, the duodenum is also supplied by the branches from the proper hepatic. Before going to the branches, I want to tell the branches from the celiac trunk first. Here is the celiac trunk, which is the artery of the foregut, and it divides, it gives a branch which is called as common hepatic artery. Common hepatic artery further divides into two arteries, which is called proper hepatic artery. The other is the gastroduodenal artery. Okay, the celiac trunk is giving rise to common hepatic. Common hepatic is giving rise to proper hepatic artery and gastroduodenal artery. Gastroduodenal artery, we know it is related to the posterior part of first part of duodenum. And now this gastroduodenal artery will give rise to superior pancreatico-duodenal artery, which is the primary artery of upper part of duodenum. And the other branch is the right gastroepiploic artery. So the gastroduodenal is dividing into two branches, superior pancreatico-duodenal and gastroepiploic artery. Gastroepiploic artery also gives some branches before supplying the stomach. It gives some branches to the first part of duodenum. And let's see the other branches which are supplying the duodenum. Here there is a branch which is called as right gastric artery, also meant to supply the stomach. So before moving towards the stomach, the right gastric artery gives rise to small branches which supply the initial part of duodenum. And see, these are the major blood supply of duodenum. And coming to the venous drainage, all through the relations we saw the duodenum is related to splenic vein. It is related to splenic vein, and it is related to portal vein, and it is related to superior mesenteric vein. So the duodenum drains into these three veins because it is related to these three veins: splenic, portal and superior mesenteric vein. And let's see the lymphatic drainage. The lymph nodes which are related to duodenum are called as pancreatico-duodenal lymph nodes. We know the duodenum is like a letter C. So along the concavity of the duodenum, that is within the concavity, we know that it is occupied by the head of the pancreas. So between the head of the pancreas and the duodenum, there are lymph nodes which are called as pancreatico-duodenal lymph nodes. So duodenum drains into these pancreatico-duodenal lymph nodes, and from these lymph nodes it is further drains into hepatic celiac lymph nodes, and lower lymph nodes drains into superior mesenteric lymph nodes. So that is the lymphatic drainage. About the nerve supply of duodenum. Duodenum is supplied by sympathetic and parasympathetic. Sympathetic is derived from T9 segment and T10 segment. T10, we know it is supplies around the umbilicus. T9 and T10 sympathetic. Parasympathetic is by vagus. So the vagus forms plexus around the celiac trunk, which are called as celiac plexus. And these celiac plexus, via these arterial branches which are supplying the duodenum, it supplies the duodenum. So that is about the nerve supply of duodenum. So next we shall see about the applied aspect and spotters of duodenum. So we shall go back to our case. The case was 45 years old man, presented with an abdominal pain, and the pain intensity reduces after food intake. And at the end of endoscopy, it was diagnosed that he is having an ulceration in the duodenum, which is called as duodenal ulcer. And duodenal ulcer is most common in the first part of duodenum, because the food present in the stomach is acidic, and the partially digested food in the stomach is called as chyme. And this acidic chyme, once enters into the duodenum, that is the first part of duodenum, because of its acidic nature, it may cause disruption of mucosa of duodenum, leading to duodenal ulcer. The another diagnostic tool is the barium meal to detect the ulcers and other pathology of duodenum. Barium meal, where barium sulfate solution is given to the subject with an empty stomach and empty duodenum. And this procedure is done to view the esophagus, stomach, duodenum. Here we can see the duodenal cap. The initial first part of the duodenum, it is again split into two parts. That is the initial most, which is covered by the peritoneum, which is the continuation of pyloric part of the stomach, and later which continues the rest of the first part is the non-peritoneal, retroperitoneal, which continues to form the second part. That initial part, which is covered by the peritoneum, forms the duodenal cap, because interiorly the duodenum has got some mucosal folds which are absent in first part of duodenum, results in the formation of this cap in barium meal. And disruption of this cap, or deformity or absence of this cap, shows the peptic ulcer or duodenal ulcer. This is a dissected cadaver to show the duodenum. Here we can see the duodenum, the first part of duodenum, which is the continuation of pylorus, and second, the vertical part of the duodenum, third, horizontal part of the duodenum, which continues to form the fourth part. Fourth part ends to form a duodeno-jejunal flexure, further continues into jejunum. So this is the duodenum, and within the concavity of the duodenum, we can also appreciate the pancreas. Pancreas continues to form the body and tail of the pancreas. Pancreas has got head, neck, body and tail. So these are the head and neck are present within the concavity of duodenum. This is a dissected part showing the interior of duodenum, where we can see circular folds present within the wall of duodenum, and it is related above to the anteriorly, it is related to inferior part of the liver, and we can see the diaphragm and spleen, and stomach is removed here to show the duodenum, and we can see the pancreas and pancreatic duct opening into the duodenum. The hepatic duct and pancreatic duct joins to form hepatopancreatic duct, which opens at the major duodenal papillae of second part of duodenum. This is the picture to show the major duodenal papillae, and one more opening is present along with major duodenal. Above to it is minor duodenal papilla, which is the opening of accessory pancreatic duct. And here is a dissected specimen to show the duodenum again, and within the concavity of the duodenum we can see the head and neck of pancreas, and here is the stomach, which is continuing as duodenum. This is a spotter. The pinned organ here is the duodenum, and we can see the pancreas along with the duodenum. So often asked question is, identify the pinned organ and mention its blood supply relations of first part or second part, or its lymphatic drainage and nerve supply. And pinned part of the organ is the second part of duodenum. So pinned part of the organ is the second part. The structures opening into the second part are major and minor duodenal papilla. I hope you all like my session. Please like, share, subscribe, and press the bell button for further notifications. Bye.